Picture this with me. It's 2,000 years ago. We're in Jerusalem, in the courtyard of the Beit HaMikdash, the Holy Temple. We're in a crowd of other worshipers. It is Yom Kippur, the most important day of the year. The Kohen Gadol, the high priest, has spent a week alone in study. He's wearing special garments. He is preparing to enter into the very center of the temple, into the Kodesh Kodeshim, the Holy of Holies. He, and it was always and only a he is going to engage in very precise and very complex rituals to purify the temple from any spiritual contamination. And as part of this, he's going to seek forgiveness three times over for himself and his household, for all the priests, and finally for all of Israel, for us. He's going to do the scapegoat ritual, choosing between two goats, one to be sacrificed on our behalf in the temple, and one sent off to die in the wilderness with our sins symbolically on its head. Three times over, he's going to pronounce God's name, not one of the acronyms or pseudonyms we ordinarily use, but the truest and most ineffable. And each time we hear him say that most powerful and most holy name, we, all of us, will fall on our faces in awe and humility and will proclaim God's glory. And when it's all over, the high priest will emerge from the temple with his face shining brighter than a lightning bolt, and we will all accompany him back to his home. What drama! The early rabbis recorded this ceremony in the Mishnah after the destruction of the temple, and it's often recited aloud on Yom Kippur as the avodah service. The Mishnah's account suggests that our ancestors felt certain that this ritual, done correctly, would be entirely effective. The temple would be purified, and everyone would be forgiven. All the priests, all the people of Israel. Our ancestors ended Yom Kippur in celebration and joy, buoyed by this certainty. In our day, we have no such spiritual technology beyond Yom Kippur itself to achieve such a certain outcome. Those of us who are religious but not fundamentalist live with uncertainty. It's not easy. For me, one of the most important moments of this story is right at the end, after it's all over. That's when the other priests and the people in the courtyard accompany the Kohen Gadol back to his house. A week of preparation for an extended ritual of the highest consequence. And then he goes home, back to the ordinary, and the people go along with him. No one, not even the high priest, can dwell perpetually in a state of intensity. No one can continuously experience that much certainty. He is, we presume, changed by this experience each and every year. And still, in the end, life goes on. The laundry needs to get done. The dishes need to get washed. We too toggle back and forth between intensity and quiet, between high stakes and the everyday, between Kodesh and Khol, ordinary and holy. This is true for each of us, and this is true for all of us. Just like the high priest, when he prayed for forgiveness for ever greater groups of people, concentric circles widen out from us. And there's paradox. At the same time, it's all one big circle. We are all connected. We are all interdependent. Yom Kippur insists that my sins are bound up in yours. My guilt is bound up in yours. My forgiveness is bound up in yours. Our very well-being, our very existence is bound up in each other's. At the most intense moments and at the most ordinary. Yom Kippur, this whole high holiday season, is an invitation to look toward ultimate matters, to consider the most important things in our life, to experience awe and humility, to take responsibility and chart a new path forward, and then to go back to our everyday lives and live out our values and live out our commitments. There is no high priest to do the work of atonement for us. We have to do it for ourselves as best we can. We each do it individually so that we are better able to come together in our interconnectedness, so that we can make manifest God's presence through our actions. May we have clarity and courage in this process, and may we find community and support as we move through the holidays and through life. This is how we can, even in the most challenging times, choose life and cultivate justice and joy. Shana Tova u'Metuka, a sweet and a happy and a healthy New Year.